The 0.1 updates are now released. This is iOS 18.1, macOS 15.1. And this is a big deal because this is the Apple Intelligence update. We finally get to start using that for real. So here's your reminder to start learning app intents. Because remember, the way your app interacts with Apple Intelligence is going to be through app intents. Not quite right now, because this is the first version. I think it's still labeled beta, but in the future, app intents are going to be a huge deal for apps in the Apple ecosystem, so learn app intents. Today's video is sponsored by Squarespace. AI tools for iOS developers are advancing rapidly. Of course, most of us probably use ChatGPT, Claude, or whatever LLM, but now the IDEs are getting into the picture. And lately with GitHub Copilot for Xcode, which was just announced a couple days ago, and also iOS development using Cursor and VS Code. So I have a couple articles to get you started if you want to explore this new world, because like I said, the way we're building apps is rapidly changing. I personally am taking the wait and see approach because, you know, like I said, GitHub Copilot for Xcode, Cursor and VS Code, Swift Assist is still coming. Xcode's predictive autocomplete should improve, right? Hopefully. But my point is, I don't have the bandwidth to be on the cutting edge, bleeding edge of this where I'm experimenting, trying all of these. So I'm gonna wait for a winner to emerge and then I'll jump on as an early adopter. That's the approach I'm taking to all this, but I recommend you follow along with like what's going on with all this stuff. So that's what these articles are. So like I said, GitHub Copilot was announced for Xcode. This is an extension onto Xcode, so you're still using the Xcode IDE. That's the big difference between GitHub Copilot and Cursor with VS Code is you gotta learn a new IDE with VS Code. For some of you, that's no big deal. For some of you, you may not wanna mess with that. Just wanna let you know the difference. But what is all this AI stuff? Essentially, it's autocomplete on steroids. Let's take a look at Thomas Ricard's blog. He's got Copilot articles and Cursor articles, so you can check him out for both, but I'll scroll down to his GIF here. He talks about GitHub Copilot, just to give you an idea of what it is. As you can see, he's creating a post struct. You're getting the autocomplete on the tab. That's not that impressive. But as you can see now, he's tabbing through the state variable, creating an array. He's just tabbing, and you'll see in a little bit, he'll create a VStack for the UI. You just hit tab, 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 and you get all this. Now, of course, this may not be the exact UI you want, but you have a basic setup that you can easily go in there, change, adjust, and this AI autocomplete should get better over time. So big picture, the Xcode predictive autocomplete, GitHub Copilot for Xcode, Cursor, this is basically what it is. Tabbed autocomplete that writes a lot of the code for you, making you more productive, saving you time. And like I said, I believe this whole landscape has some time to play out between all these competitors. And I'm gonna wait for a winner to emerge before I jump on board. But I wanted to share with you what's going on, because like I said, I just truly believe between talking with ChatGPT or Claude every day, these IDEs improvements, the way we build apps is changing. So even if you don't jump on board right now, I still think you should know what's going on. And like I said, Thomas Ricard's blog, he's really diving in. I'm following him to stay up to date. And then also Rudrank has a bunch of Cursor articles. He's really taking a deep dive into Cursor. So he would be the go-to for Cursor if you're interested in that. Apple has announced the Swift Student Challenge, the dates for it, right? Applications will open in February 2025 for 3 weeks. So you got a few months to build those apps. And I love this every year because it's so fun for me to see what the kids are building, right? Because I've said this before, but when I was 18 in high school, like I was just playing video games. I was not ambitious at all. I was not doing any of this coding stuff. So it's mind-blowing to me when I see some of the apps that these 15, 16, 17-year-olds are making. It just blows my mind. So I love seeing this. So if you are a student, start working on those apps and you can submit them in February of 2025. For the past week or so at my day job, Podcast AI, I've been going down the rabbit hole of making the app more performant, right? Getting rid of hangs, making the UI super snappy, improving my Swift data fetches, all that stuff. And in that process, I stumbled across this article from Jacob, High Performance Swift Apps. And I wanted to share it because the concepts and his thought process are what I found very interesting and very valuable. Because he's talking about an app where he checks for two-factor authentication codes and finds interesting ones, like there's five fives or everything's in order, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's kind of irrelevant for what I wanted to share this article for. Again, it's the thought process, it's the concepts, right? He talks about, I'm not gonna scroll through the article because again, it's mostly about that, but talking about identifying bottlenecks and, you know, fixing things upstream of the bottleneck or downstream of the bottleneck and how that affects things. He talks about using actors to run your code in parallel, which is a good concept everyone should know. And he also talks about executing certain bits of code at different times to again, speed up the perceived performance. So like I said, when you check out this article and read it, yeah, you might learn a little bit about two-factor authentication codes, but the main idea is to hear his thought process, learn about these general concepts because it gave me a lot of ideas on how I could improve the performance of my app, and I think it will for you too. Next up, we got Bruno Rocha talking about working at startups versus large companies. And this is a age-old, I was going to say debate. It's not really a debate. It's just personal preference. But I wanted to share this because I think a lot of people, especially that are like new to the space, new to this industry, they think getting that job at Google, getting that job at Apple, getting that job at Meta, whatever, like the big FANG companies, that is like the holy grail. That is what you want. And I used to think that too. I used to think that like I needed that stamp of approval. I needed that prestige. I needed that credibility that I worked at one of these companies. But they're very, very different experiences. And you may enjoy that large company atmosphere, or you may enjoy the startup atmosphere. And that's what this article is all about, talking about the pros and cons, right? The pros of working at a startup, you get great experience in a wide variety of topics because usually it's a small team, 2, 3, 4, 5 people. So you got to basically do everything. So you get experience in a wide variety, huge potential for growth for that reason I just said. Here's the big thing though, and this is why I'm a startup person. That's where I lean. Little to no bureaucracy or politics. We'll get into that with the large companies too. Generally great community, great vibe. Again, small team, it's intimate. It's just the best way to work in my opinion. For me, I should say. Not even in my opinion. I should say for me and how I am, that's the best way. But there are cons, right? The pay is usually not as good as, you know, the FANG companies. It is very unstable. These small startups maybe raise a little bit of money, so they got like a year of burn rate, or maybe they need to cut costs to extend the runway. So yeah, it is definitely unstable. He does talk about no engineering challenges. I think this can be hit or miss depending on what you're doing, but it is true that startups prioritize speed. It's like, hey, just get it done, get the MVP out there, all that stuff. Work is complete chaos, that is true. If you love order and nice and neat and be told what to do, exactly how to do it, that's, startups aren't for you. And then here's probably the biggest con that I felt in my career too is most likely going to work with a product nobody cares about. So the two of the three startups I worked for, like the app never even saw the light of day. Like one of them, well, one did launch, but like, didn't really go anywhere. The other one never even made the app store. It was like a prototype being sent to investors and all this stuff. So yeah, you're probably gonna work on a product no one's ever heard of, no one cares about. And obviously if you work at, you know, the big FANG companies, large companies, that's a different story. But I wanna go to the cons of the big company because he also does mid-level, which is kind of like a medium of the two. You know, the pros, life-changing pay and benefits, you know, pay is good. The engineering challenges are usually a lot harder because, you know, you're building a app that, you know, millions, maybe even hundreds of millions of people use. So that's different engineering challenges than just building an MVP of a startup. Opportunity to work with some of the smartest people on the planet. You know, you can read this too. But here's the big thing that I want to point out. Unbearable politics. And I like that he said unbearable. Not like, oh yeah, you got to deal with some politics. And by the way, politics isn't like people talking about politics. It's like all the red tape. I think he goes through it down here. When you work at a startup, if you want to do something, you just go there and do it. But when you work at a large company, if you want to do something, you're going to have meeting about a meeting to draft a document for a meeting. That's what he means by politics, bureaucracy, and red tape. Like to get anything done just takes forever. And if you're like me, who like is just excited about this stuff, wants to move fast, like startups are for you. And look, I get that a lot of this meeting after meeting and documents might be necessary, again, when you're dealing with a banking app that has, you know, 50 million users, or, you know, YouTube with a billion users. Like, that makes sense. Again, it's just two different environments. So what environment do you think is right for you? But the reason I wanted to share this is because I think the default idea, the default thought process is I need to work for FANG. That's what makes me a good developer. And that's just not true. I'm assuming we pretty much all use user defaults at some point in our app. So I wanted to share this article from Christian Selig about a weird bug in user defaults. And I'm going to summarize it. Definitely check it out because he goes into great depth on explaining what's going on. But I'll give you the gist of it. User defaults is meant to persist small bits of data that aren't sensitive, right? Like you don't care if it leaks, but it might be very functional to your app. So he used the example of like, if you're keeping track of a user streak, maybe if they open the app every day for a month, you do something cool. And maybe you store the, you know, app open count as an integer in user defaults. Well, what Christian has discovered is this weird bug is now lately, I'll try to go down and find it. I believe as of iOS 15, yeah, starting with iOS 15, iOS will sometimes wake up your app so that when a user launches it, you know, down the road, it launches even quicker, right? It's called application pre-warming. And then also with live activities, you know, your app gets woken up in the background. To put it super simply, to give you the concept and the gist, again, go check out the article, iOS wakes up your app behind the scenes at certain times, you know, for various reasons. But what happens is sometimes when it wakes up, it doesn't have access to user defaults. So when it goes in to fetch that last opened app date or whatever, it doesn't have access to it. So it returns nil. So if your code, if you're like, oh, it returns nil, this must be the first time they've ever launched it. Let me go ahead and overwrite this new date. I guess the last open app date is a bad example because that's always going to be the same. But if you were keeping track of that int, right, that streak of how many times you've opened the app, you know, it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and they've opened the app for 7 days, and then now iOS opens your app in the background, pre-warms it, you don't have access to that user defaults, and then you overwrite that as like, oh, this is the first time they've opened the app. You know, they've lost their streak is the example he uses. But I wanted to point this out. It is a weird bug. So if you are using user defaults, keeping track of anything like that that can be overwritten, keep an eye out for this and definitely dive into this article. Next up, I want to share this SwiftUI Animations video from Chris Idoff, who helps write the book Thinking in SwiftUI. By the way, their content, if you want to know the nitty-gritty of SwiftUI, you want to become a SwiftUI wizard, you want to know what's going on under the hood, their content is for you. For example, look, he's talking about SwiftUI animations, but he's walking through the SwiftUI render tree. What happens under the hood at every step? That's the kind of knowledge you're going to get from the Chris Idoff or Thinking in SwiftUI content, right? Maybe you just want that quick little article. Oh, if I type this 2 lines of code, I get this cool SwiftUI animation. Cool, I'm good. If that's all you want, not for you. If you want to know the ins and outs, the nitty gritty, this is just amazing content. So you can see him walking through the render tree at every single step and going through like the animation. I'll fast forward a little bit. He runs through like how the animation actually renders. So yeah, I highly recommend checking out this video if you really, truly want to know SwiftUI animations. And if you are the type that wants to know the nitty gritty of SwiftUI, wants to know all these animations, I know you're building amazing apps, and I always recommend having an online iOS developer portfolio to showcase your work so people can find you, learn about how good you are, learn about what you do. And that brings me to today's sponsor, Squarespace. Squarespace is an all-in-one platform to help you get that iOS developer portfolio up and running very quickly. Now I know, we're developers, we can build a website ourselves, but we're also iOS developers, and I would argue there's an opportunity cost of your time. Now, do you want to spend your time learning about web development, responsive design, all the different browsers, or do you want to spend your time building apps? So that's why I always recommend letting Squarespace take that off your plate to build your iOS developer portfolio. They have all kinds of beautiful themes and templates to get you started, and you can use their next generation website editor with the Fluid Engine to just really unlock all the creativity in the world. You can even use Squarespace Blueprint and Squarespace AI to help you figure out what to write on your website, because that's always the hardest part. Like, I don't even know what to say here. Throw it into Squarespace's AI and they'll help you out. They handle all the SEO and analytics for you. Again, Squarespace handling your website just takes so much off your plate. So when you're ready to get started, go to squarespace.com. And when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/SeanAllen to get 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain.